Happy Sunday morning. Welcome to another episode of Collider Mailbag, and I'm your host, John Rocha, getting ready. I stretched out this morning, had some good breakfast because I knew I was going to get in the ring with one of my favorite friends and colleagues and also adversaries, Jeff Snyder. Welcome back to Collider Mailbag. How are you?
I'm great. I'm curious, though, John, what did you have for breakfast this morning?
I had eggs and turkey sausage and pancakes. So I'm all carved up.
Wow.
I'm all proteined up. Let's do this. How about you? How are you?
I don't eat breakfast. It's for the week.
Fair enough. No, I really just had oatmeal. That's the way it goes now.
Oatmeal. I got my oatmeal.
All right. Wilford Brimley. How are you doing overall, man? How's it going with you?
I'm hanging in there, guys.
Yeah. All right.
Looking forward to CinemaCon. Looking forward to some March Madness.
Yes.
Kicked off.
Yeah. Scott Mance was on yesterday for Mailbag, and he mentioned that the Tribeca Film Festival is coming up as well, and they're doing a 40th anniversary of Apocalypse Now called Apocalypse Now, the Final Cut. Which will be a whole new cut of the movie, and it'll be released in 4K later. That's exciting. That excites me.
I thought you were going to say 40th anniversary, like, celebration of Scott Mance.
No, oh,
like, it's definitely
be nice.
Beyond 40.
Don't say that. We don't know. Anyway, all right, so we're going to answer some questions. You know, Jeff's been on the show before.
I love you, Mance. Well,
yeah, we both do. We're going to answer some questions from you, the fans. As always, you know how it is when we put the call out on Instagram, on Twitter. Please put that hashtag Collider Mailbag when you're answering so I can find your questions and have them selected for the show. You can also email us, mailbag@collider.com, and I go through all those as well, pick out some of the best ones. I picked out about 15 to 20 this time around, sent them to Jeff. Jeff picked out 5 he was really excited about. Those are the ones we're going to talk about here. So
I get first dibs over Mance.
Yeah, you do. Always. All right. Let's jump into it. Our first question.
I'm just killing Mance. Yeah,
you are. Because, you want to do better. I get it. It's a Sunday show. Cody Guest. This is the email from Cody Guest. He writes, if you could pick one movie character to go on a week-long vacation with, who would it be and where would you go? Jeff's side.
Oh, boy. Well, I think it depends on the type of vacation you're trying to have. Because it's like I picked a guy and a girl.
Okay. You want to balance.
Yeah, because it's like, is it a romantic vacation?
Right.
You know?
Right.
Like, who knows? All right. Either way, I picked two characters, both from the same universe.
Okay.
And that is the Judd Apatow universe.
All right.
So if I had to go away with a guy on a vacation, you want someone who you're going to be able to have some fun with, get along with. He's going to make you laugh. He's going to be cool. I think I would go with Seth Rogen's Ben Stone from Knocked Up.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like before he figured things out or after he figured things out?
When he was like a schlubby
So Ben Stone at the end of the movie, Ben Stone at the beginning of the movie.
Yes, that's a fun guy.
The guy having
not
his friends
Mr. Responsible,
pink eye?
Yeah.
Okay.
Listen, if I have to get pink eye, I think that means that the week went well.
Yeah, I guess so.
And if I had to take a lady.
Yes.
On a week-long vacation, it would be Mila Kunis's Rachel Jansen from Forgetting Sarah Marshall.
I would go right
back to where that movie's set. I'd go back to Hawaii at the, Turtle Bay like that?
Yep.
I don't know what it is, but
it's got to be a
shout-out. That place was beautiful. She's beautiful. She's so cool in that movie. She's just, like, a lot of fun. And, those would be my two picks. What about you, John?
That's a great choice. I would have to pick, for me, the number one character I would go on a trip with is Indiana Jones. I would absolutely go for a week-long vacation with Indiana. And I'll tell you why. Because he would be full of stories about his exploits, about what he went through. Plus, if I was a single guy, I'm sure he would attract some ladies over to our table.
So you like some adventure.
Conversation. Of course. And then, of course, he would find his way into some adventure, finding some kind of, and I'd be tagging along,
be
figuring it out.
Mutt Williams.
I'd be Mutt, exactly. Or John Rhys Davies. I'd be one of his guys hanging out with him, trying to solve whatever they're trying to solve or get the artifact.
Okay.
That would be a lot of fun. Female-wise, I think Sandra Bullock, Gracie Hart from Miss Congeniality. I would love to hang out
with her. Okay, she is Miss Congeniality,
yeah,
after
Miss
all.
Congeniality. And the Gracie at the end of the movie, when she's a little more, like, less judgmental, a little more understanding, it would be great to hang out with her. Plus, I know I'd be, if there was any kind of thing that went down, I got an FBI agent hanging out with me that can handle the
business.
Oh, you
feel safe.
Yeah, I feel safe with her. But if I had both of them, that would be the ultimate. That trilogy or trio would be a lot of fun to hang out with. certainly
you,
for
Indiana
a week
Jones and Miss Congeniality. I like it.
Some good conversations.
That sounds
else.
Like fun.
Because Indiana Jones would say this, this, and this, and she'd be like, "You know, you broke the law here, here, and here." So oh. That would be a lot of fun out there, just getting high, listening to those two going at each other.
Whoa. Okay.
What do you do? You do with Ben Stone? It's certainly getting high, son.
I didn't know we're talking about that here.
Yeah, we can do it. All right. What's the second question we got?
It comes from Instagram and from Spoopstagram.
Yeah, I don't know.
Nice name. What Oscar-caliber director would you like to see take a stab at the horror genre? I think Tarantino's witty dialogue and brutal imagery would translate perfectly.
Well, the top two for me were Ang Lee and Iñárritu. And Iñárritu comes so close to being horror with some of his films, like with The Revenant, even with Birdman, that's more of a contemplative film. The Revenant is a really gritty, cold, stark film about the dangers of revenge, right? Well, how hard you can push yourself when you want to get revenge on somebody. And I would like to see that in a horror aspect. The way he does that would be incredible. Ang Lee would be more of a contemplative horror, reflective horror. We saw a little bit of that in The Hulk. And in Brokeback Mountain, you see what he can do with these characters as they explore a taboo subject at their time. What can he explore in horror that he could bring out through that? And the Ice Storm, if you saw in the Ice Storm, those dinner scenes alone, so much tension. So you know he knows how to build tension just from human interaction. Throw in a horror aspect to it, it'd be a lot of fun.
So this is, all right, well, yeah, because I guess we have two questions that are kind of the same today. But so it's what Oscar-caliber director would take a stab at the horror genre? I'd like to see Steven Spielberg.
Really?
Yeah, do a horror movie. Because I know obviously he kind of did Poltergeist, right? That's the rumor.
Tobe Hooper is credited as having done Poltergeist.
Yes, that is sort of the rumor. But yeah, exactly. Spielberg's never really done a proper one. I mean, unless you count Jaws, which you could.
That is a horror, in my opinion, yeah.
You could. So that would be interesting, and also like PTA.
Paul Thomas Anderson.
Yeah. Oh, Paul Thomas Anderson doing a horror movie, I think, would be super interesting.
Would you argue that Plainview is a villain?
No, I can see that argument, but I don't think that means it's a horror movie.
No. I'm saying, if he can get that kind of performance out of Daniel Day-Lewis.
Oh, PTA could direct the hell. Like, he could direct, like, an Oscar-winning villain turn similar to, like, Heath Ledger in Dark Knight or Javier Bardem in No Country for Old Men.
Right.
So Christoph Waltz. You know?
Exactly. And so you could see that horror aspect come into a movie like that with his direction
I could see him definitely directing like a supporting actor to an Oscar win in a horror movie.
Yeah, I could see that as well.
That'd be interesting.
All right, let's move on to our next one. It is from Chelsea McIntyre. It's an email. Hey, Collider Crew. I've been thinking about this for a couple of days and wondering what your thoughts are. If you could recast the Avengers with any actor/actress from history, who would you choose? My answer would be cast Jimmy Stewart as Captain America, Catherine Hepburn as Black Widow, and Cary Grant as Iron Man. As always, keep up the good job. Thank you for all that you do. Snyder!
Wow, what a question.
This is a great question.
I kind of love this one because I love anything to do with casting. So I say we go one character at a time, back and forth.
Okay, sounds good.
My Iron Man.
Stop cheating, by the way.
I'm looking at
you. I know you are. I don't like it. Go ahead.
My Iron Man would be Tom Cruise.
Oh,
as Tony Stark. Which I think if they were they ever interested him.
I think they were
for that early on.
They were. The rumors are he didn't like the fact that his face would be covered by a mask, right. So he didn't do it.
Big mistake.
Who
Tom.
Knows if it's true.
Iron Man, Tom Cruise, hands down.
Okay, Iron Man, Clark Gable. Yeah. Billionaire playboy, smirk on his face, rapid fire dialogue. Watch him in Gone with the Wind again. Not one of my favorite movies.
Is he tough?
But he is. Clark Gable? I will submit to you the Misfits, and you tell me if he's tough or not.
Ooh.
An aging cowboy at the end of his career. He's tough as nails in that movie. Mogambo, tough as nails in that movie. He is a tough dude, Clark Gable, and he's been through it all, and he would have that twinkle in his eye that Iron Man has.
All right.
Go ahead.
Captain America.
Yeah.
Robert Redford.
Ooh, nice choice.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was kind of perfect that he ended up in that franchise anyways. But yeah, young Robert Redford with that twinkle in his eye and that kind of like, you know, goody two-shoes American.
Right.
Yeah, I like it.
I chose Paul Newman. And I like
I was thinking of Paul Newman too. I mean, I think we're right on the same page there.
Well, with Paul Newman, most, with Robert Redford, he has tackled some political things in his movie 3 Days of Condor, The Candidate, that are the question, you know, what we've been presented in our society. Captain America, through the trilogy, does that, especially in Winter Soldier. So I think Paul Newman consistently does that through all his films, and I think he would have the right to. Plus, you could see him wearing the Captain America thing and kind of championing America, right? And then also questioning what America is doing with that intelligence, like he does with Nick Fury. I think he'd be great.
His cool hand Luke body. I can see that decked out in the armor.
Hello.
Black Widow, Deborah Winger. I'm just kidding. That was Deborah Winger, right? I'm going to go with
Winger, nice choice.
90s badass.
Oh.
Demi Moore.
Oh, Demi would be a good Black Widow.
Yep.
I liked it. I guess I went a little older than you. I was trying to explore because it's a little bit tougher for me to go down there, but that's a nice choice.
You were thinking more like classic.
Yeah, classic film stars. Actors. So I put,
it did say it said any
Jimmy
time,
Stewart.
Didn't
they
it?
Did. They did. So okay. When he mentioned, or when, I don't know if Chelsea's a man or a woman, so
Chelsea
could be
know.
Either way. They mentioned Jimmy Stewart, Katharine Hepburn, and Cary Grant. That's where my mindset was. So for me,
I see.
Black Widow, Elizabeth Taylor. Elizabeth Taylor.
That would be very good.
In that black outfit and also playing both sides. We've seen her as she got older play roles like Butterfield 8 and Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, where she can play both sides, hero and villain, quite effortlessly in the same movie.
I like that Demi Moore can kind of be like a seductress, but also like a badass, like you saw in G.I. Jane.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how she'd do with like a Russian accent if she kind of needs one.
Yeah,
I mean, right? It's she's Russian, isn't she?
I don't know if she ever did a Russian accent.
But well, yeah,
Scarlett
I don't know.
Has yes to do a Russian.
I like where we're at. So I have Cruise, okay. Redford, Demi Moore, and you have Paul Newman,
Clark Gable,
and
Elizabeth Taylor.
Okay.
Who is a pretty strong seductress herself back in the day.
Hulk. Who do you have for Hulk?
I have Robert Redford as the Hulk.
Wow. So you have Redford on your Avengers squad too, but not as Cap. Okay.
No, he could wear the glasses, Hulk. So he'd be the scientist Hulk.
You can see him
and
being really
angry. And then when he
angry?
Turns up and getting angry, he'd be like, kind of it'd be such a nuanced thing. Look, Mark Ruffalo is as meek as they come when you see him in most movies. All of a sudden, he's the Hulk. Robert Redford can play the intelligent scientist aspect of Banner and then have issues with his anger. If you've seen him, if you watch 3 Days of the Condor, he's pretty vicious to Faye Dunaway in certain scenes. You could see him hulking out and getting angry.
I just see, I guess I can't wrap my head around it because to me, Robert Redford's like the nice old man at Sundance.
Yeah, well.
Like, I can't see him hulking out, but okay.
All right.
My Hulk, and this might be a little bit tougher for him to play Bruce Banner, but Michael Clark Duncan. I think him Hulk, like as the Hulk is like this kind of like sensitive scientist who then is just like gigantic. That would be so cool to me if only he was with us.
Well, he could play the Hulk, but then you'd have to have someone play Bruce Banner, right?
He would play Bruce Banner.
Both.
He would just be like a big scientist, a guy who doesn't look like a scientist from the outside, but like, you know.
Okay. All right.
That's why he would sort of assume Hulk form.
Who do you have for Thor?
Thor. All right. I think of a guy, he's got to be like blonde and beautiful and have like this great mane of hair and be chiseled. So I went with Patrick Swayze.
Oh, interesting.
Patrick Swayze as Thor. That's right. I like it.
I went with Vincent D'Onofrio. No. That's Adventures in Babysitting. I went with Marlon Brando.
Oh, you're really going deep for the classics.
Come on. Okay. Marlon Brando as the Hulk would be. I mean, as Thor would be incredible. You could see him with the long hair and the chiseled physique, you know, kind of carrying that hammer.
I cannot picture Brando as Thor. I am struggling right now, I gotta be honest.
Have you seen Streetcar Named Desire? He is like a sexy, strong, muscular guy in that movie. And in freaking On the Waterfront, he's more of a slower guy, but he's still driven by a moral and a principle. All of that. As Thor would be very interesting. And if you throw in who I'm going to throw in as Loki, that chemistry would be interesting.
Are we going that deep? I only did those five.
You did? Oh, okay. Well, let
me
throw
in.
I got Hawkeye, Steve McQueen as Hawkeye. That would be a badass seeing him flinging arrows. And I think that would be the Hawkeye people would like more than the Jeremy Renner Hawkeye, who gets a lot of flack from the fans.
Okay.
A Steve McQueen Hawkeye would be interesting. I went James Dean for Ant-Man. And my last one was, my last two. Loki as Yul Brynner as Loki would be very interesting. I've come to rule you. Mm-hmm. And Lee Marvin Estados.
Man, I don't know how old our audience is, but if they know half these people, I'll be impressed.
Well, you know,
Lee Marvin Estados is good. I like that. Yeah,
he'd be great. Lee Marvin Estados. All right, let's move on to our next question, since you don't have any more. What's our next one there, Jeff?
All right.
If you can recover in time.
It is an email from Fred Castillo, okay, who writes, "Hey, Collider Mailbag, I recently saw Captain Marvel twice and liked it more the second time than the first. My question to you is, what is the best movie you've seen that you like better the more you saw it? Mine is Dogma, which became my favorite movie of all time. Thanks for taking my email and have a great day." Fred C., Dogma's your favorite movie of all time. Wild, man. That's
okay.
Wild.
Interesting okay. choice.
Fair enough.
I have three. Watchmen, I've already said on numerous programs how I've loved the director's cut, and I watch it now incessantly whenever it's on TV or if I'm in the mood, I'll put it on. Not the original cut, the director's cut. I've learned to appreciate that film more and more over the years. Anchorman is one that got better as I watched it more and more, but probably The Big Lebowski is the number one thing. When I walked out of The Big Lebowski, I was like, okay, I get it. It's funny. It's not until I watched it over and over and over again that I really got what the Coen brothers were going for and understood the humor and enjoyed the performances and really got what the film was trying to do. And I've learned to appreciate that film so much over the last 10 years.
I think I'm with you on Anchorman and Big Lebowski. Mm-hmm. Those are probably movies that I was maybe a little too young when I first saw them. Mm. Not necessarily with Anchorman. I was definitely too young when I saw Big Lebowski, and some of the stuff sailed over my head.
Right.
The more I watched it, it got better. Anyways, mine. I think comedies are like that, though.
Yeah.
Mine's a comedy too. I want to see if you get it just from the quotes. Okay, all right.
John? Here we go.
Oh, Billy.
So Cable Guy.
Cable Guy. That's right. The Cable Guy is my movie.
I didn't really
like The Cable Guy when I first saw it because it's like, you know, I think I was 12 years old when that movie came out. I'd seen Ace Ventura, Dumb and Dumber. Like, it was wacky Jim Carrey. And then this was just like a different side of Jim Carrey that I didn't necessarily like, but the more that I watched The Cable Guy, I've come to appreciate its brilliance and what it's saying just about like television and entertainment and friendship and just, I don't know. There's a lot of stuff that I think holds up really well in that movie, particularly Jim Carrey's performance.
It's prescient on a lot of issues we're dealing with now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when reality TV, look who a reality TV president, like it's mind blowing when you look at rewatch Cable Guy and see how many things Ben Stiller was kind of talking about or foreshadowing that was going to happen in our world, in our entertainment, and in our technology, and how it was going to change us. It's really interesting. And by the way, shout out to Ben Stiller being on the Bill Simmons podcast recently. I don't know if you've listened to that episode yet. I listened to it on the way in this morning. They dropped it this morning as we're recording this, and it's a fantastic episode. So if you want to listen to something, interview with Ben Stiller, go and listen to it at the Bill Simmons. Okay, let's move on to our last one, and it's an email from Jason Georges. Howdy, Outlaw, he writes. A trend I've noticed recently is several directors who are known for their work in horror have made the jump over to big blockbusters, particularly superhero movies. Some examples are Scott Derrickson with Doctor Strange, David F. Sandberg with Shazam, James Wan with Aquaman, and Neil Marshall now with Hellboy 2019. Which director known for their horror films would you like to see make a superhero movie, and which hero would you choose? Personally, I think Mike Flanagan, who did A Haunting of Hill House and Gerald's Game, could have a great take on Moon Knight, a hero who suffers from dissociative identity disorder. Thanks for taking my question. Regards, Jason. All right. What you got, Riley?
These are guys Snyder. Who've worked in horror who I want to see directing a superhero
mm-hmm.
movie.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
All right. I think, like, you know, Adam Wingard is someone who has obviously been getting bigger and bigger budgets to work with
mm-hmm.
from Death Note at Netflix to now he's doing that Godzilla movie.
Yes.
So I could see Warner Brothers, if that Godzilla movie goes well, I could see them giving him, you know, something in the DC universe mm-hmm. perhaps, although he may have already turned stuff down. I'm curious about this director of Brightburn, which, you know, looks like a superhero movie of sorts, but like it's a horror movie technically.
Right.
Like, could this guy become the next James Gunn who becomes a big horror movie director? Mm-hmm. But then, you know, the one that I'll say, even though I wasn't really a big fan of Us, which I still encourage all of you to see mm-hmm. And let me know what you think, Jordan Peele.
Okay.
Jordan Peele doing a superhero movie, I think, would be really interesting. Mm-hmm. I think that he showed his skill for like shot composition in Us.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, with the right script, I think there are elements to Peele's work that would really, you know, do well with, you know, within the superhero genre.
Yeah. Go. All right. I like the idea of Karen Kusama, who just did The Invitation, did Destroyer. I like her getting involved in some way. Because, look, Black Widow is nice. Captain Marvel is nice. These are good. Wonder Woman is cool. But there are some darker female heroes in the superhero universe. And I think getting a female horror movie director to latch on to some of these heroes and explore their darker stories would be very interesting. And Black Widow does have a darker story, but when you cast Scarlett Johansson, I think you're only going to go so deep into that and into the darkness of it all. I think there's a lot of superheroes that you can explore with Karen Kusama.
Who are some of the ones that you would...
You know, when you look at the Justice, like, Black Canary has got an interesting story behind her. If you look at the X-Men, Psylocke has interesting stuff going on with her. If you explore even more, I know the Dark Phoenix thing has been done already with Jean Grey, but can you imagine if it had been done with a horror movie director? There would have been more to explore there. You can go through a plenty of lists of superheroes who have a darker edge to them and darker vibe to them, and I think Karen Kusama could bring that out, and that would be a lot of fun to see. Do you have any superheroes yourself that you would love to see come to the screen offhand?
No, not really.
It's not your jam. No. Oh, I know, Jeff. You're not a big fan.
I mean, I love Saga.
Yeah.
Saga's okay. Amazing. Dennis is wearing a Lion Cat shirt today in the office. I just want to tear it off of Dennis. And, well, I always want to tear Dennis's shirt off. But anyways, I think that's it.
If you did a Catwoman with Karen Kusama, that could be interesting as well, with what she confronts in the Gotham universe and the things she has to go. And imagine a Karen Kusama Harley Quinn solo movie. That would be a lot of fun as well.
It would. You know, they got this other female director, Kathy Ann.
Right, for Birds of Prey. Right. But one would be interesting. Yeah. All right, well, these were awesome questions. I want to thank everybody for sending those questions in, and I want to thank Jeff Snyder for taking the time to stop by. Jeff, where can people find you, my friend?
At The N Snyder on Twitter, on Instagram, and on Cameo.
That's right. I need to get on that. I keep getting those notifications.
This has been like 2 months. I need to get on that. I know. You need to play basketball, too, on Saturdays,
true,
John.
True. Well,
where were you this weekend?
I'm in love. Leave me alone. All right. Well, listen, you can follow me at The Roka Says as well on Twitter and on Instagram. But more importantly, you, the fans, can send these questions in for these episodes of Mailbag. You can do so when we put the call outs on Twitter and on Instagram. When we put it through the Collider video account, you can see those there and put the hashtag Collider Mailbag on your response so I can find it.
You just hashtagged your fingers.
Yeah. And you can email us at mailbag@collider.com. I go through those questions. And like I said at the beginning of the show, I send them to my guests. See which five they like a lot, and those are the ones we answer on the show, which is a lot of fun. So thanks again for sending these great questions through. Subscribe to Collider Video, like and share this video on your social media, and comment in the comment section below. Let us know what your answers to these questions are, and enjoy the rest of your Sunday, and we'll see you next weekend for another two episodes of Collider Mailbag.
Have you seen my computer?